Chapter 14 of Famous Sea Fights by John R. Hale. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Barry Eads. Famous Sea Fights by John R. Hale. Chapter 14, Part 1. Tsu-shima, 1905. When the War of 1894-95 between China and Japan was brought to a close by the Treaty of Shimonoseki, 17 April 1895, the Japanese were in possession of Korea and southern Manchuria, Port Arthur and the Liaotung Peninsula, Weihui and the Pescadores Islands, and a joint naval and military expedition was ready to seize Formosa. By the second article, China ceded to Japan the fortress and dockyard of Port Arthur and the Liaotung Peninsula. As soon as the terms of the treaty were published, Russia, which was the northern neighbor of China along the borders of Manchuria and Mongolia, and the neighbor of Japan by the possession of Vladivostok and Saghalien, protested against the cession of Port Arthur and its territory to the victors, arguing that the permanent occupation of Port Arthur by a foreign power would be a standing menace to the government at Peking, and would put an end to the independence of China. Germany and France joined in the Russian protest, and the three powers began to move their ships eastward. Their combined squadrons would have been more than a match for Admiral Ito's cruisers. England had a powerful squadron in the eastern seas, but observed a strict neutrality in the diplomatic strife. If England had joined her, Japan would undoubtedly have fought rather than yield up the fruit of her hard-won victories. But the Mikado's ministers realized that single-handed they could not face a triple alliance of aggressive European powers. The treaty was revised, the cession of Port Arthur and its territories being struck out of it. They were to be restored to China. But the statesmen of Japan, while they yielded the point, recognized in Russia their future rival for the Empire of the East, and resolved to begin at once preparing for a struggle in years to come which would give them back more than they were now forced to abandon. They set to work to create a powerful navy, and at the same time added steadily to the fighting strength of their army, which for a while found useful war training in the subjugation of the hill tribes of Formosa. The millions of the war indemnity and loans negotiated abroad were expended on a great scheme of armaments. A fleet of battleships, cruisers, and torpedo craft was built in foreign shipyards, and the personnel of the navy was increased to provide officers and crew. The Japanese government went on for years patiently preparing, regardless of conduct on the part of Russia that might have tempted a less self-possessed power to premature action. The Russian government had hardly forced Japan to abandon so large a part of her conquest when it took advantage of the weakness of China to obtain from the Peking government the right to make a railway through Manchuria to the treaty port of Niuquang, and to place garrisons along the new line for its protection, and further the right to garrison Port Arthur, use it as a naval station, and occupy the adjacent territory. When the first rumors of the Russo-Chinese treaty reached Europe, they were treated with incredulity. It was said that it was impossible that Russia could cynically claim a position which she had just declared was incompatible with the independence of China, and which she had argued the nations of Europe could not permit to Japan or any other power. But presently the treaty was published and acted upon, Russia making Port Arthur her chief naval station in the east, announcing a project for a great commercial port at Talanwan Bay, and further occupying the treaty port of Niuquang. There was a brief period of tension during which there was a talk of various powers resisting this barefaced aggression, but European statesmen thought that an easier course was open to them. Instead of resisting the aggressor, they embarked in a policy of aggression themselves, on the plea of securing compensations and guarantees. The weakness of China made her the ready victim for this policy. Foreign aggression from so many quarters called forth a patriotic movement in China, which in 1900 culminated in the Boxer Revolt. For a while, Japan and the European powers, including Russia, became allies to save their embassies and repress the rising about Peking. In the campaign, the Japanese forces proved themselves the most efficient of all, and their chiefs returned home with an absolute confidence that they could successfully meet European soldiers in the field. Japan had made the most unsparing use of its rights in Korea, acquired by the Treaty of Shimonoseki, all but absolutely annexing the country. After the Boxer Revolt, Admiral Alexeyev, who was governor of the Russian possessions in the Far East, embarked on a dangerous policy of provocation towards Japan. He had an ill-informed contempt for the hardy islanders. he underrated their power of resistance, and felt sure that the mere fact that the Russian fleet outnumbered theirs would secure the command of the sea for Russia, and have a decisive effect in the event of a conflict. He believed that the sooner it came, the better. The Russian fleet in the east was steadily reinforced, unit by unit. The Japanese people began to see in these proceedings, and in the work done at Port Arthur, a threat of early hostilities, and there was a general call on the government to anticipate the blow, when relations became strained between the two countries in 1903. The Tokyo government was anxious not to precipitate the war, for the organization of the army required some months for completion, but the feeling in the navy, army, and civil population forced its hand. After a brief delay of negotiations, during which both parties worked with feverish energy to secure additional armaments, diplomatic relations were broken off at the beginning of February 1904, and then, without waiting for any formal declaration of war, the Japanese torpedo flotilla swooped down on the Russian fleet lying in the roads outside the narrow entrance of Port Arthur, found them utterly unprepared to meet this sudden attack, and crippled several of the ships. A second blow was the destruction of the first-class armored cruiser Varieg, the Russian guardship at Chemulpo, by a Japanese squadron. Most of the best ships in the Russian Navy were in the east at the outbreak of the war. Alexeyev had, however, made the initial mistake of dividing the force at his disposal. Away north at Vladivostok was a squadron of three large armored cruisers, the Gromoboy, Rosha, and Rurik, and the protected cruiser Bogatyr. The Varieg was isolated at Chemulpo, the port of Seoul, doing duty that might have been left to a gunboat. At Port Arthur, under Admiral Stark, there was a strong fleet, including seven battleships. The Petropavlovsk, Poltava, Peresviet, Pobeda, Retsevan, Sebastopol, and Tsarevich. The cruisers Askoid, Boyarin, Bayan, Palata, Diana, and Novik, and a flotilla of torpedo craft and the mine-laying steamer Yenisei. In the torpedo attack on the evening of 8 February, the Retsevan, Tsarevich, and Palata were badly damaged. The Varieg was destroyed next day, and a few days later, the Yenisei accidentally blew herself up while laying mines. This series of disasters seemed for a while to have almost destroyed the morale of the fleet. Stark set to work to repair his damaged ships, made no attempt to meet the Japanese at sea, or interfere with the transport of their armies to the mainland of Asia, and, subordinating his fleet to the defense of Port Arthur, even landed guns and men to strengthen the landward works. The Japanese blockaded the port, insulted it with long-range bombardments, and tried to block the narrow entrance by sinking old steamers across it. In March, the arrival of the best officer in the Russian Navy, Admiral Makarov, for a while inspired new energy into the Port Arthur fleet. The repairs of the injured ships were completed, and on 13 April, the Admiral steamed out to challenge Togo and the main Japanese fleet in battle. Notwithstanding precautions taken against the known danger of floating mines, the fleet entered a track of water where several were afloat, and the flagship Petropavlovsk was destroyed with fearful suddenness by the explosion of one of them. There was great loss of life, but the most serious blow to Russia was the death of the Admiral. After the fleet returned to the harbor, there came another period of irresolute inactivity. It was not till August, when several ships had been injured at their anchors by the bombardment from the land batteries of the Japanese attack, and it was evident that the port would soon be a dangerous place for the ships, that Admiral Witjeft proceeded to sea, announcing that he was going to Vladivostok, the cruiser squadron from that port having been warned to come out and reinforce him on his way. The sea fight, known as the Battle of the 10th of August, took place a few miles to seaward of the port. Witjeft led the fleet in his flagship, the Tsarevich, followed by the battleships Retsevan, Sebastopol, Pobeda, Poltava, and Peresviet, carrying the flag of the second-in-command, Rear Admiral Prince Ukhtomsky, and the cruiser division made up of the Askoid, carrying the flag of Rear Admiral Retzenstein, Palata, Diana, and Novak, besides eight destroyers. The cruiser Banyan had been so damaged that she was left in port. Witjeft had a marked superiority in battleships. Togo had had six new first-rate ships of the class under his command at the outset of the war, but on 15 May he had lost two of them, one-third of his battleship fleet, by a disaster like that of the Petropavlovsk. On that May morning, while cruising off Port Arthur, he ran into a field of drift mines, and in a few minutes the battleships Hatsus and Yashima and cruiser Yoshino were destroyed. The Japanese managed till the end of the war to conceal the fact that the Yashima had been lost, and the Russians up to the Battle of Tsu-shima believed Togo had five of his big battleships intact. In the Battle of 10 August, he put in his main fighting line the two powerful armored cruisers, Nishan and Kasuga, purchased from the Argentine government on the eve of the war. The battle began with long-range firing at 1 p.m., and continued till after 7 in the evening. It was decided by the superior gunnery of the Japanese and the damage done by their high-explosive shells. The Tsarevich, badly cut up and set on fire, was driven out of the line. Witjeft was killed by a shell. His last word was to reiterate his order to push for Vladivostok. As darkness came on, Uktomsky lost heart and led the fleet back to Port Arthur. If he had held on, he might have got through the Japanese fleet, for their ammunition was almost exhausted when the firing ceased. Retzenstein, with the cruisers, tried to execute Witjeft's last order. The Pallada, however, left him and followed the battleships. The rest of the cruiser squadron and the destroyers that accompanied it were forced to part company, and only the Novik got through to the northwards. The Diana fled southwards to the French port of Saigon. The Askold, with a destroyer, reached Shanghai. The battered Tsarevich, with three destroyers, took refuge at Kiao Chau. All these ships were disarmed by the French, German, and Chinese authorities and detained till the end of the war, when they were restored to the Russian government. The Novik failed to get into Vladivostok, but reached a Russian port in Saghalien, where a few days later she was tracked down and destroyed by Japanese cruisers. The Vladivostok squadron had come out to meet the unfortunate Witjeft. The Boyarin was left behind, damaged by accidental grounding, so the squadron was made up of the three big armored cruisers, Gromoboy, Rosha, and Rurik. They were approaching the Straits of Tsu-shima, and were as far south as Fusan, when they were discovered and attacked by Admiral Kamimura's cruiser squadron on 14 August. Once more, good gunnery against poor shooting decided the fight. The Rurik was sunk, and the Gromoboy and Rosha returned to Vladivostok, bearing marks of very hard hitting. Riddled funnels and sides hastily patched with plates of iron told of the straight shooting of the Japanese cruisers. In both the action with the Port Arthur battleship fleet and the Vladivostok cruiser squadron, the losses of the Japanese had been very slight. On paper, the Japanese had had a distinct superiority over the Japanese in sea power at the outset, so far as it can be measured by balancing off battleships, cruisers, and minor craft in parallel columns. In the months before the war, there was ample material for the enterprising journalist to work up a Navy scare at Tokyo. But once more it was shown that not the number of ships, but the temper and training of the men are the true measure of power on the sea. From the first, Togo had asserted his superiority, and by asserting, secured it. After the naval engagements of 10 and 14 August, the Russian Navy in the Far East accepted a position of helpless inaction. Uktomsky kept what was left of the fine fleet that had been originally assembled at Port Arthur, anchored in the landlocked harbor till the ships were sunk by fire of the besieging batteries. While the Far Eastern fleet was still in being and Port Arthur was holding out, the Russian government had announced its intention of sending a second fleet from Europe to the seat of war. It had two fleets in European waters, those of the Black Sea and the Baltic. The Black Sea fleet was not available. International treaties barred its exit from the Dardanelles. Only the Baltic dockyards could supply the new armada. As soon as the news of the first torpedo attack on Port Arthur arrived, in February 1904, there was talk of the new fleet for the East, and unofficially the end of June was spoken of as the time when it would be ready to sail. From the first it was obvious that this was an over-sanguine estimate, unless the fleet was to be made up entirely of old and weak ships. The best units that could be made available, and without some at least of which the fleet could hardly be sent out, were five powerful battleships that were being completed, in the Neva yards and at Kronstadt. Two had been launched in 1901, two in 1902, and the fifth in 1903. But even on the 1901 ships there was a large amount of work to be done. Naval experts declared that the fleet would not be ready for a year, and that even then, the difficulty of coaling would make its voyage to the other side of the world in wartime a hopeless task for the admiral in command. By hard work, the fleet was made ready for sea by the middle of September. The coaling difficulty was overcome by taking colliers with the fleet, contracting with a German firm to send large coal-laden steamers to various points on the route selected, and straining to the utmost the benevolent neutrality of France, and using her colonial ports as halting places on the way. There was some difficulty in recruiting a sufficient number of engineer officers and of stokers who could manage the Novell tubular boilers of the new battleships, and the fleet was undoubtedly handicapped by the inexperience of its engine room and stokehold staff. Admiral Rojdestvensky, the officer chosen for the supreme command, had an excellent record. He was 56 years of age and had served in the Navy since 1865. In the Russo-Turkish War, he had distinguished himself by brilliant attacks on Turkish ships of the war with a small torpedo gunboat, the Vesta. He had been naval attaché in London, and had filled important technical and official positions in St. Petersburg, being for a while chief of the General Naval Staff. Finally, he had personal knowledge of the Eastern Seas and of the Japanese Navy, for he had commanded the Russian squadron in the Far East during the war between China and Japan. On 14 August, just after the news of the disastrous sortie of the Port Arthur fleet had reached Europe, and on the very day the Kamimura defeated the Vladivostok squadron and sank the Rurik, Admiral Rojdestvensky hoisted his flag on board his flagship, the Kanias Suvorov, at Kronstadt. But there was still much work to be done, and recent mishaps to some of the ship's machinery to be made good, so the fleet did not sail till 25 August. Even then it was only for a few days' training cruise in the Baltic. On the 30th, the fleet was back again at Kronstadt. Engineers and mechanics worked night and day, setting right defects in the ships, and on 11 September there was another start, this time for the port of Libau. The fleet consisted of 7 battleships, 2 armored cruisers, and some protected cruisers and torpedo boat destroyers. It was to be joined at Libau by a miscellaneous collection of craft, some small cruisers, and a number of merchantmen to be used as auxiliary cruisers, store, hospital, and repair ships. Of the 5 new battleships in the Neva yards, 4 had been got ready for sea. These were the Borodino, Orel, Imperator Alexander III, and Kanias Suvorov. They were powerful ships of 13,000 to 13,500 tons displacement, with engines of nominal 16,000 horsepower, and their official speed, which they never realized, was 18 knots. Their heaviest armor was 9 inches, and they carried 2 pair of 12-inch guns fore and aft in armored turrets, with an auxiliary armament of 12 6-inch quick-firers besides lighter guns. The 3 other battleships, the Asliabia, Navarin, and Sisoy Veliki, were older ships. The newest of them, the Asliabia, launched in 1898, was on her way to the east when the war broke out, and had turned back. She was of 12,600 tons displacement, and claimed a speed of 18 knots. She carried 4 10-inch and 11 6-inch guns. The other 2 ships were rated as having 16 knots speed, but probably could not much exceed 12. Their displacement and principal armament were Navarin, 10,000 tons, 4 12-inch guns, 8 6-inch quick-firers. Sisoy Veliki, 8,880 tons, 4 12-inch guns, 6 6-inch quick-firers. The 2 armored cruisers were old ships. Admiral Nakhimov, 8,500 tons, 8 8-inch, 10 6-inch guns. Dmitry Donskoy, 7,796 tons, 6 6-inch, 10 4.7-inch guns. 2 of the protected cruisers, the Aurora and Oleg, were ships of about 7,000 tons, carrying for their main armament the former 8 and the latter 12 6-inch guns. The other cruisers were 4 smaller ships, but some of them were comparatively new vessels with good speed, useful as scouts. Well manned with competent engineers and trained gunners, the fleet would have been formidable enough, notwithstanding its weaker units, but here again it was the men that counted. In the first week of October, the fleet was taken to Revel. The Tsar arrived there on the 9th and inspected it next day. On the 11th it sailed, but it stopped again at Libau until October 15, when at last it started for the east. There had been wild rumors that the Japanese had sent emissaries to Europe, obtained some light craft, and fitted them as improvised torpedo boats for the purpose of attacking the fleet on its voyage through the narrow waters that form the exit from the Baltic or during the crossing of the North Sea. The Russian police attached such importance to these canards that Rojdestvensky was warned to take precaution against attack until he was out in the open ocean. He passed the Danish Straits with his ships partly cleared for action, fired on a Swedish merchantman and a German fishing boat, and, avoiding the usual course from the Skaw to the channel, ran by the Dogger Bank, and in a panic of false alarm opened fire on the steam-trawling fleet, sinking a boat and killing and wounding several men. The result was an outburst of indignation in England, a partial mobilization of the British fleet, and some days of extreme tension, when it seemed likely that England would be drawn into the war, with the probability that France would then, under the terms of her alliance with Russia, have also to enter into the conflict. An agreement was arranged under which there was to be an international inquiry into the Dogger Bank incident, and Russia promised to make full reparation. Meanwhile, the Baltic fleet had run down channel and across the Bay of Biscay, and southwards to Tangier, where it was concentrated on 3 November, watched by Lord Charles Beresford and the Channel Fleet, for the period of sharp tension was not over. At Tangier, Rojdestvensky divided his force. He went southward along the African coast with the 1st Division, and sent the 2nd Division, under Admiral Fölkersham, into the Mediterranean to go eastwards by the Suez Canal route. A 3rd Division had been formed at Libau to reinforce the fleet. It was composed of the armored cruisers Izumrud and Oleg, 3 auxiliary cruisers, armed liners of the volunteer fleet, the Terek, Rion, and Denapir, a flotilla of destroyers, and a number of storeships. It sailed from Libau on 7 November. Rojdestvensky put into various African ports, mostly in the French colonies, and coaled his ships from his colliers. He was at Dakar in West Africa on 13 November, at Gaboon on the 26th, in Great Fish Bay on 6 December, and at Angra-Pequena on the 11th. He passed Cape Town on 19 December. Rounding the Cape, he steered for Madagascar, and on 1 January 1905 he anchored in the Bay of St. Marie near Tamatave. On that same New Year's Day, General Stoessel sent a flag of truce out to General Nogai to inform him that he was anxious to arrange the immediate surrender of Port Arthur. The capitulation was signed next day. Thus, at the very moment that Rojdestvensky and the main fighting force of the Baltic fleet established itself in the Indian Ocean, its nearest possible base in the Eastern Seas passed into Japanese hands, and the problem the Russian admiral had to solve became more difficult. Fölkersham, with the 2nd Division, rejoined Rojdestvensky's division in the waters of Madagascar. From St. Marie the fleet moved to the roadstead of Nasi Bay, at the north end of Madagascar, where it was joined in February by the reinforcements for Libau. Rojdestvensky had now under his command an armada of some 40 ships of all kinds, including storeships and colliers. Now that Port Arthur had fallen, he seemed in no hurry to proceed eastwards. There had been an agitation in Russia for a further reinforcement of the fleet, and though the addition of a few more old and weak ships could add no real strength to Rojdestvensky's armada, the government yielded to the clamor, and on February 15 dispatched from Libau a 4th Division, under the command of Admiral Nebogatov. The flagship was an armored turret ship, the Imperator Nikolai I, of 9,700 tons, dating from 1889, and classed in the Navy list as a battleship. With her went 3 small armored coast defense battleships, the General Admiral Apraksin, the Admiral Ushakov, and the Admiral Sinyavin, all of 4,000 tons, and the cruiser Vladimir Monomakh, of a little over 5,500 tons. Rojdestvensky seemed inclined to wait at Nasi Bay for Nebogatov's arrival, but the Japanese addressed strong protest to Paris against Madagascar being made a base of operations for a huge expedition against them. The French government sent pressing remonstrances to their friends at St. Petersburg, and the admiral was ordered by cable to move on. Sailing from Nasi Bay on 25 March, Rojdestvensky steered first for the Chagos Archipelago, and then for the Straits of Malacca. In the afternoon of 8 April, the fleet passed Singapore, keeping well out to sea. The ships were burning soft coal, and an enormous cloud of black smoke trailed from the forest of funnels. Steamers ran out from the port to see the splendid sight of the great crowd of ships moving 4 abreast into the China Sea. Before the fleet sailed, many critics of naval matters had prophesied that as Russia had no coaling stations, the coaling difficulty would make it impossible for Rojdestvensky ever to carry his fleet so far. The successful entry into the Eastern Seas was therefore regarded as something of an exploit. It was a revelation of the far-reaching power that would belong to better-equipped fleets in future wars. With the Baltic fleet on its way, the Japanese government, patriotically supported by the press and the people, kept a strict silence on all naval matters. There were wild conjectures that under this veil of secrecy, Togo had moved southwards, that he would fall on his enemy during the voyage across the Indian Ocean, or wait for him in the China Sea. But the Japanese admiral had no reason for embarking on such adventures. He knew that if he kept his fleet near the shores of Japan, his enemy must come, sooner or later, within effective striking distance. Rozjestvensky might attempt a raid on the coasts of Japan, or make a dash for Niu Chuang to seize that port, now the nearest base of supply of the Japanese field army. Far-seeing precautions were taken against this eventuality by accumulating enormous stores of supplies in the immediate rear of the army. But it was far more likely that the Russian admiral would try to reach Vladivostok, either with or without a battle. To do so, he would have ultimately to pass through one of the three channels into the Sea of Japan. He must choose between the Korean or Tsushima Straits between Japan and Korea, or the Sagara Channel between Nippon and Yozo, or the Lapero Straits, known to the Japanese as the Soya Channel, still further north. Whatever course he chose, the best position for the Japanese fleet was near the Tsushima Straits, with the arsenal and dockyard of Shimonoseki close by on the Japanese shore. This, the Russians themselves foresaw, would be the most likely position for Togo to select. He made Masampo Bay on the Korean side of the straits, and inside them, the Douglas Bay of our Admiralty charts, the station for his fleet. Freed from all harassing blockading and cruising work, he devoted the period between the retirement and destruction of the Port Arthur fleet in the late summer of 1904 and the approach of the Russians in May 1905 to repairing his ships very thoroughly, substituting new guns for those they had mounted at the beginning of the war, which had had their rifling worn down. Continual target practice and maneuver exercises kept every ship and every man up to the mark. Charts of the sea around Japan were ruled off into small numbered squares so as to facilitate the reporting of the enemy's position and movements from the moment he would be first sighted. An elaborate system of scouting by light cruisers was organized. Signal stations were established on islands and headlands, and wireless installations erected at central and outlying points. If Rozjestvensky made for the Tsushima channels, Togo was there to meet him. If he went for either of the northern straits, the Japanese admiral counted on having news of his movements in sufficient time to enable him to steam at full speed by a shorter route and still interpose between the Baltic Armada and Vladivostok. After passing Singapore on 25 March, there was another delay before the final advance of the Russian fleet. Rozjestvensky was anxious to give time to Nebogatov to join him. This last reinforcement was coming by the Mediterranean route. The Russian commander-in-chief again strained French neutrality to the utmost. In April and May, he passed week after week in the ports of French Cochin China, first at Kamran and then at Van Phong or Han Kohi. Here, early in May, he was at last joined by Nebogatov's squadron. Again, Japan protested the use of French harbors by her enemy. The diplomatic tension became acute, and at one moment it seemed as if the Russian admiral were anxious to produce complications that would force France into the war. But at last, to the general relief, on 14 May he sailed from Hankohe Bay. He passed through the Bashi Strait between Formosa and the Philippines, and then steered for Shanghai. Here, on 25 May, the fighting portion of the fleet lay out at sea, while a crowd of auxiliary steamers, colliers, storeships, and armed merchantmen were sent into the Wusung River, the mouth of the Yangtze, and anchored there. End of Chapter 14, Part 1. Chapter 14, Part 2 of Famous Sea Fights by John R. Hale. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Barry Eads. Famous Sea Fights by John R. Hale. Chapter 14, Part 2. Their appearance without the fleet to which they belonged led to many conjectures. The Japanese at once grasped its real meaning. To quote the message cabled by the Tokyo correspondent of the Times, they read it as a plain intimation that Rozjestvensky intended to put his fate to the test at Tsushima, since, had it been his purpose to make for Sugaru or Soya, he must have retained the services of these auxiliary ships during several days longer. It is apparent, indeed, that the Russian admiral here made his first cardinal mistake. He should have kept his non-combatant vessels out of sight as long as possible. Their absence from the arena would have been a mysterious element, whereas their apparition, especially as a segregated squadron in the Yangtze River, furnished an unerring clue to expert observers. With the fleet, the admiral retained only the hospital and repairing ships, and those laden with naval stores for the Vladivostok dockyard. On the evening of the 25th, the fleet stood out to sea, heading for Tsu-shima. The weather was bad, with a probability that it would be worse. There was a rising wind and sea, with cold rain that made a blinding haze. But the Russian staff officers were rather pleased than depressed at such unpleasant conditions. Thick weather would baffle the Japanese scouts and lookout stations, and rough seas would keep their torpedo flotillas at anchor. Out ahead were the fast cruisers of the scouting division, the Svetlana, Almaz, and the Ural. After these came the main body of the fleet, in line ahead in two columns, the heavy armor-clads on the starboard, right side, the rest of the armored ships and four cruisers in the port line. Abreast of the leading ships, each flank was guarded by a cruiser and two torpedo destroyers. After the fighting lines and between their foaming wakes steamed four store ships and two repairing ships. Last of all were the two steamers fitted as hospital ships. The arrangement is best shown by a rough diagram. Leading were the cruisers, Svetlana in the middle, Almaz on the port, and Ural on the starboard. Port line. The Imperator Nikolai, the Admiral Senyavin, the Admiral Apraxin, the Admiral Yushchikov, cruisers Oleg, Aurora, Dmitry Donskoy, and Alexander Monomakh, and five torpedo destroyers. They were flanked on their port side by the cruiser Jemshug and two torpedo destroyers. The starboard line, the Kineas Suvorov, the Imperator Alexander, the Borodino, the Orel, the Asliabia, the Sisoy Veliki, the Navarin, and the Admiral Nakhimov. They were flanked on their starboard side by the cruiser Izumrud and two torpedo destroyers. Behind and to the center were the storeships Anadyr, Irtysh, Korea, Kamchatka, repairing ships and tugs, Sphere and Rus, and hospital ships Oral and Kostromo. In this order, the great fleet steamed slowly through the rain and darkness. On board the great battleships, there was much grumbling at Nebogatov's old tubs, though they themselves could not do much better, for poor coal, inefficient stoking, and weed-grown bottom plates handicapped even the newest of them. The next day, 26 May, was the eve of the greatest naval battle in all history. The clouds began to break, and the sun shone fitfully, says Captain Semenov. But although a fairly fresh southwesterly wind had sprung up, a thick mist still lay upon the water. Rozhdestvensky meant to pass the perilous straits in daylight, and he calculated that by noon next day the fleet would be in the narrows of Tsu-shima. Behind that portal of the Sea of Japan, Togo was waiting confidently for his enemy, who, he knew, must now be near at hand. Never before had two such powerful fleets met in battle, and the fate of the East hung upon the result of their encounter. That result must depend mainly upon the heavy armored ships. In these and in the number of guns of the largest caliber, the Russians had an advantage so far as mere figures went, as the following tables show. Armored ships. Battleship class. Japan 4, Russia 8. Coast defense armored clad class. Japan none, Russia 3. Armored cruiser class. Japan 8, Russia 3. Total armored ships. Japan 12, Russia 14. Heavy guns. 12-inch, Japan 16, Russia 26. 10-inch, Japan 1, Russia 15. 9-inch, Japan 0, Russia 4. 8-inch, Japan 30, Russia 8. Quick firers. 6-inch, Japan 160, Russia 102. 4.7-inch, Japan none, Russia 30. With regard to the armor, it must be kept in mind, for purposes of comparison, that the armored belts of the newest ships, 9 inches at the thickest part, were of Harveyized or Krupp steel, and could resist penetration better than the thicker belts of the older ships. It will be noticed that the Japanese carried fewer of the heavier types of guns, but had more 6-inch quick-firers than the Russians. This is a point to bear in mind in following the story of the battle. It was the steady rain of 100-pounder shells from the quick-firers that paralyzed the fighting power of the Russian ships. Far more important than the mere number of guns was the fact that the Japanese shot straighter and had a more effective projectile. There was such a marked difference between the effect of the Japanese shells at Tsu-shima and in the naval battle of 10 August 1904 that Captain Simonov, who was present at both battles, thought that in the interval the Japanese must have adopted a more powerful kind of high explosive for their bursting charges. This was not the case. Throughout the war, the Japanese had used for their bursting charges the famous Chimose powder. But perhaps between 10 August 1904 and the following May, they had improved their fuses so as to detonate the charge more certainly and thoroughly. The first five battleships on the Russian list were up-to-date modern vessels. The Navarin was fairly fit to lie in line with them. The rest were, to use a familiar expression, a scratch lot, coast-defense ships of small speed and old craft quite out of date. The decks of the larger ships were encumbered with an extra supply of coal, and this must have seriously diminished their margin of stability, with, as we shall see, disastrous results. Admiral Togo could oppose to them only four modern battleships, but his two heavy cruisers, the Nishin and Kasuga, the ships bought from Argentina on the eve of the war, might almost have been classed as smaller battleships, and certainly would have been given that rank a few years earlier. His fine fleet of armored cruisers were at least a match for the Russian coast defense ships and the older battleships. Besides his armored ships, Admiral Rozhestvensky had a squadron of six protected cruisers under Rear Admiral Enquist, whose flag flew in the Oleg, a vessel of 6,750 tons launched in 1903 and completed next year. She had for her principal armament 12 six-inch quickfirers. The other cruisers were the Aurora, of a little over 6,000 tons, the Svetlana, of nearly 4,000, the Jemshug and the Izumrud, of 3,000 tons, these two armed with 47 quick-firing guns, and the Almaz, of 3,285, a scout of good speed, carrying nothing heavier than 12-pounders. There was one auxiliary cruiser, the Ural, a flotilla of 9 destroyers, 4 transports, 2 repairing ships, and 2 hospital steamers. Awaiting the battle in sight of his own shores, Togo had concentrated as auxiliary squadrons to his armored fleet a considerable number of protected cruisers and a whole swarm of torpedo craft. At this stage of her naval development, and on the eve of a life-and-death struggle, Japan had no idea of scrapping even the older ships. Anything that could carry a few good guns and brave men to fight them might be useful, so even the old Chinese ironclad, which had carried Ting's flag at the Yalu battle, a ship dating from 1882, was under steam in one of the auxiliary squadrons, with 4 new 12-inch guns in her barbettes. There were 3 of these auxiliary squadrons, commanded by Rear Admiral Dewa, Rear Admiral Yuryu, and Rear Admiral Keteoka, the last having as a subordinate commander Rear Admiral Togo, a relative of the commander-in-chief. Dewa's flag flew in the Kasagi, a fine cruiser of nearly 5,000 tons, built in America, and he had with him her sister ships, the Chaitos and the Takasago. Yuryu's flag flew in the Naniwa, Togo's ship when he was a captain in the Chinese War. Several of the fine cruisers, which Ito had then led to victory, were present, many of them remodeled, and all provided with new guns. Then there were a number of small protected cruisers, built in Japanese dockyards since the Chinese War, the heralds of the later time when the Japanese Navy would all be home-built. Battleships, armored cruisers, and protected cruisers were all swifter than the Russian ships. The fleet as a whole could maneuver at fully 50% greater speed than the enemy, and this meant that it could choose its own position in battle. The 5 torpedo squadrons included 2 or 3 torpedo gunboats, 21 fine destroyers, and some 80 torpedo boats. Togo's plans had the simplicity which is a necessity in the rough game of war, where elaborate schemes are likely to go wrong. Some of the swift protected cruisers were scouting south of the straits. The fleet was anchored in a body in Masampo Bay, and in wireless communication with its scouts. The armored fleet was to make the main attack on the head of the Russian advance. The protected cruiser squadrons were to sweep round the enemy's flanks, fall upon his rear, and destroy his transports and auxiliaries. The torpedo flotilla was to be ready to dash in and complete the defeat of the enemy when his fleet was crippled by the fight with the heavy ships. Most of the officers and men of the Russian fleet had the dogged courage that could carry them through even a hopeless fight, but they looked forward to the immediate future with forebodings of disaster. Even among the officers on board the great Suvorov, there was a feeling that the most that could be hoped for was that a few ships would struggle through to Vladivostok if there was a battle, and that the best thing that could happen would be for the thick weather and rough seas to enable them to avoid anything like a close fight with the Japanese. During the last day before the fight, Rozjestvensky, who did not want to hurry forward, but was timing his advance so as to pass the straits in the middle of the next day, spent some time in maneuvers. Captain Simonov's notes on the proceedings convey a useful lesson. "Once again," he says, "and for the last time, we were forcibly reminded of the old truism that a fleet is created by long practice at sea in time of peace, cruising, not remaining in port, and that a collection of ships of various types, hastily collected, which have only learned to sail together on the way to the theater of operations, is no fleet, but a chance concourse of vessels." Wireless telegraphy had come into use since the last naval war, and a fleet could now try to overhear the aerial messages of an enemy. In the Russian fleet, the order had been given that no wireless messages were to be sent. In other words, the operators were to keep silence and listen by watching their apparatus. In the morning of the 26th, they thought they detected messages passing. In the evening, these were more frequent. Short messages of a word or two was the interpretation that the experts in the signal cabins put upon the unintelligible flickerings of the indicator, and they suggested that they were mere negative code signals from the Japanese scouts to their main fleet, repeating an indication that they were on the alert and had seen nothing. This was mere guesswork, however, and Politovsky's diary on the voyage shows that near the Cape, at Madagascar, and out in the midst of the Indian Ocean, Rozjestvensky's wireless operators had thought that they detected Japanese aerial signaling, simply because the receivers gave indications they could not understand. Possibly these were merely the effect of electric storms on the apparatus. Once or twice on 26 May, they thought they could read fragments of sentences, such as "last night," "nothing," "11 lights," "not in line." The short messages in the evening came at fixed times. This showed that prearranged signaling was really going on. It gave the impression that perhaps the fleet was being watched by unseen enemies. As the sun went down, the ships closed up, and half the officers were detailed for duty at the guns during the hours of darkness. The rest lay down fully dressed, ready to turn out at a moment's notice. Many slept on the decks. No lights were shown. Simonov's description of that night of anxious expectation is worth quoting. He was on board the flagship, the Suvorov. "The night came on dark. The mist seemed to grow denser, and through it but few stars could be seen. On the dark deck there prevailed a strained stillness, broken at times only by the sighs of the sleepers, the steps of an officer, or by an order given in an undertone. Near the guns, the motionless figures of their crews seemed like dead, but all were wide awake, gazing keenly into the darkness. Was not that the dark shadow of a torpedo boat? They listened attentively. Surely the throb of her engines and the noise of steam would betray an invisible foe. Stepping carefully so as not to disturb the sleepers, I went round the bridges and decks, and then proceeded to the engine room. For a moment the bright light blinded me. Here life and movement were visible on all sides. Men were nimbly running up and down the ladders. There was a tinkling of bells and a buzzing of voices. Orders were being transmitted loudly, but on looking more intently, the tension and anxiety, that same peculiar frame of mind so noticeable on deck, could also be observed. At daybreak, the Japanese scouts were in touch. As the day came in gray light over the misty broken sea, one of their scouts, the auxiliary cruiser, Siano Maru, an armed passenger liner, sweeping round through the haze, almost collided with the hospital ships, and then dashed off and disappeared in the twilight. In former wars she would have had to run back to the fleet with her news. Now from her wireless apparatus, the information was sent through the air to the receivers of the Mikasa and Masampo Bay, and in a few moments Togo knew that the enemy's fleet was in square number 203 of the chart, apparently steering for the eastern passage, i.e., the strait between Tsu-shima Island and Japan. In the straits and outside Masampo Bay, a heavy sea was running, and though the wind blew strongly from the southwest, the weather was still hazy at sunrise, with patches of fog here and there. The main body of the Japanese fleet began to get up anchor and slip from its moorings. At dawn, Rojdestvensky had called in the Almaz, leaving the Jemshug and the Ismarud steaming in advance of his two divisions. The six auxiliary ships had closed up, so that the leading ship, the transport Anadir, was abreast in the center of the two lines. The Almaz, Svetlana, and Ural steamed at the rear of the central line of transports to protect them in that direction. The two hospital ships, flying the Red Cross flag and trusting to it for safety, were well astern. About 6 a.m., the huge Ural came running up between the lines and semi-forward to the flagship that four ships in line ahead were passing across the rear of the fleet, but could not be clearly made out in the mist. They could only be some of Togo's cruisers shepherding the fleet. Just before 7, a fine cruiser was seen some 5 miles away on the starboard beam of the Suvorov. She closed up to 3 miles, and was soon identified as the Idzumu. The big gun turrets were swung round to bear on her, but the Japanese cruiser, having seen what she wanted, increased her distance, but could be seen still keeping the fleet in sight. Togo's report notes that at 7 a.m., the Idzumu sent by wireless the second definite report of the enemy, stating that he was 25 miles northwest of Ukushima, steering northeast. This would make the Russian position about 30 miles south of the Tsu-shima Islands, heading for the channel to the east of them. An hour later, about 8 a.m., some Japanese ships showed themselves the other side of the fleet. Semenov notes how the Chinyen, Matsushima, Itsukushima, and Hashidat appeared out of the mist, steaming on an almost parallel course. Ahead of them was a small light cruiser, apparently the Aki Tsu-shima, which hurriedly drew off to the north as soon as we were able to see her well, and equally she us, and the whole squadron began slowly to increase their distance and gradually to disappear from sight. This was Vice Admiral Takeomi's division, composed of three of the cruisers that had fought at the Yalu battle 11 years before, and the Chinyen, which had fought against them as the Tingyun. The ship that ran out ahead was the only quick or modern ship in the squadron, the small, Clyde-built armored cruiser Chiyoda. If Rojdestvensky had had any speedy cruisers available, he might have severely punished this slow squadron of old ships. Takeomi showed he knew his enemy by thus boldly approaching in the mist. The Russians now realized that they had watchful enemies all around them, and rightly conjectured that they would find the enemy's heavy ships in the straits ready for battle. At 10 a.m., another cruiser squadron appeared on the port beam. This was Dawa's division, made up of the American-built sister ships Kasagi and Chaitos, of nearly 5,000 tons, and two smaller protected cruisers, the Niitaka and Atawa, lately turned out by Japanese yards. They seemed to invite attack. At a signal from the admiral, the eight armor-clads of the starboard line steamed ahead of the port line, turned together to port, and then, turning again, formed line ahead, leading the whole fleet. At the same time, the transports moved out to starboard, guarded by the Vladimir Monomach, detached from the port division, the Svetlana, Almaz, and Ural. Dewa's cruisers held a parallel course with the Russian battleships for more than an hour, still apparently unsupported. The range was about 5 miles. At 11:20, the Russians opened fire on them. Semenov says that it was the result of a mistake. The Oral fired an accidental shot, which she immediately reported by semaphore. Unable, with smokeless powder, to tell by which of the leading ships it had been fired, the fleet took it as a signal from the Suvorov and opened fire. Of the whole fleet, the fire of the third squadron was the heaviest. This squadron was made up of Nebogatov's old tubs. Their heavy fire was probably the result of undisciplined excitement. The Japanese fired a few shots in reply, but no harm was done on either side. Rojdestvensky, who had kept the guns of his flagship silent, signaled ammunition not to be wasted, and the firing ceased in 5 minutes, just as the Japanese turned slowly and increased their distance. Orders were now signaled for the men of the Russian fleet to have their dinners, and the officers lunched in turn. The harmless skirmish encouraged some of the Russian crews with the idea that they had been in action and were none the worse, and had driven the Japanese away. At noon the fleet was due south of Tsu-shima, which towered like a mountain out of the sea a few miles ahead. The signal was hoisted. Change course north 23 degrees east for Vladivostok. It was the anniversary of the Tsar's coronation. Round the wardroom tables in his doomed fleet, the officers stood up and drank with enthusiasm to the Emperor, the Empress, and victory for Russia. The cheering had hardly died down when the bugles sounded the alarm. Everyone hurried to his post. The enemy's cruisers had again shown themselves, this time accompanied by a flotilla of destroyers that came rolling through the rough sea with the waves foaming over their bows. On a signal from the admiral, the four leading battleships turned to starboard and stood towards the enemy, then reformed line ahead on a course parallel to the rest of the fleet and slightly in advance of it. The Japanese, on the threat of attack, had turned also and went off at high speed to the northwards. At 1:20 p.m., the admiral signaled to the next four ships of the fleet to join the line of battleships, forming astern of them. The Russian armada was now well into the wide eastern strait of Tsu-shima, and far ahead through the mist, a crowd of ships could be dimly seen. The crisis was near at hand. On receiving the first wireless message from the Shinano Maru at daybreak, Togo had weighed anchor and come out of Musumpo Bay, with his main fleet steering east, so as to pass just to the north of Tsu-shima. He had with him his 12 armored ships, and Rear Admiral Uryu's division of protected cruisers, Naniwa, Takichiko, Tsu-shima, and Akashi, and a strong flotilla of destroyers. The smaller torpedo boats, more than 60 in number, had been already sent to shelter in Mairua Bay, in the island of Tsu-shima, on account of the heavy seas. During the morning, Togo received a succession of wireless messages from his cruisers, and every mile of the enemy's progress, every change in his formation, was quickly signaled to him. Shortly after noon, he was able to note that the Russians were entering the straits, steaming at about 12 knots on a northeasterly course, that they were formed in two columns in line ahead, the starboard column being the stronger, and that they had their transports astern between the columns. He decided to attack them on the weaker side at 2 p.m., when he calculated that they would be near Okinoshima, a small island in the middle of the eastern strait, about halfway between Tsu-shima and the southwestern headlands of Nippon. At 1:30, he was joined by Dewa's division of cruisers, and a few minutes later the divisions of Katioka and the younger Togo rejoined. They had till now hung on the flanks of the Russian advance. At 1:45, the enemy's fleet came in sight, away to the southwestward of Okinoshima. Flags fluttered up to the signal yards of the Mikasa, and the fleet read with enthusiasm Togo's inspiring message. "The rise or fall of the Empire depends upon today's battle. Let every man do his utmost." He had been about 10 miles north of Okinoshima at noon, by which time he had steamed some 90 miles from Douglas Bay since 5 a.m. Thence he turned back slowly, going west and a little south, till he sighted the Russians. He crossed their line of advance diagonally at about 9,500 yards distance. His light cruiser divisions had received orders to steam southwards and attack the Russian rear, and were already well on their way. The heavy Japanese ships, circling on the left front of the enemy's advance, put on speed and were evidently intending to recross the bows of the battleship division, bringing a converging fire to bear on the leading ships, the maneuver known as crossing the T. As the Mikasa led the Japanese line on its turning movement, Rozhdestvensky swung round to starboard and opened fire at 8,500 yards. Togo waited till the distance had shortened to 6,500, and then the guns of the Mikasa flashed out. At that moment only three other of his ships had made the turn. They also opened fire, and ship after ship, as she came round into line, joined in the cannonade. The Russians turned more slowly, and it was some time before the whole of their line was in action. Meanwhile, a storm of fire had burst upon the leading ships of Rozhdestvensky's lines. The Suvorov and the Oslyabya, at the head of the starboard and port divisions, being each made a target by several of the enemy. The Japanese gunners were firing with a rapidity that surprised even those who had been in the action of 10 August, and with much more terrible effect. In Captain Simonov's narrative of the fate of the Suvorov, we have a remarkably detailed description of the execution done by the Japanese shells in this first stage of the battle. The opening shots went high. They flew over the Suvorov, some of the big 12-inch projectiles turning over and over longitudinally in their flight. But at once Semenov remarked that the enemy were using a more sensitive fuse than on 10 August. Every shell as it touched the water exploded in a geyser of smoke and spray. As the Japanese corrected the range, shells began to explode on board or immediately over the deck, and again there was proof of the improved fusing. The slightest obstacle, the guy of a funnel, the lift of a boat derrick, was enough to burst the shell. The first fair hit was on the side, abreast of the forward funnel. It sent up a gigantic column of smoke, water, and flame. Then several men were killed or wounded near the forebridge, and then there was a crash beside one of the quick-firers, and the shell, bursting as it penetrated the deck, set the ship on fire. In the battle of 10 August, the flagship Tsarevich, which had borne the brunt of the Japanese fire, had been hit just 19 times. But now that the Mikasa and her consorts had got the range, hit followed hit on the leading Russian ships. It seemed impossible, says Semenov, even to count the number of projectiles striking us. I had not only never witnessed such a fire before, but I had never imagined anything like it. Shells seemed to be pouring upon us incessantly one after another. The steel plates and superstructure of the upper deck were torn to pieces, and the splinters caused many casualties. Iron ladders were crumbled up into rings, and guns were literally hurled from their mountings. Such havoc would never be caused by the simple impact of a shell, still less by that of its splinters. It could only be caused by the force of the explosion. In addition to this, there was the unusually high temperature and liquid flame of the explosion, which seemed to spread over everything. I actually watched a steel plate catch fire from a burst. Of course, the steel did not burn, but the paint on it did. Such almost incombustible materials as hammocks and rows of boxes drenched with water flared up in a moment. At times it was almost impossible to see anything with glasses, owing to everything being so distorted with the quivering heated air. No, it was different to the 10th of August. In this storm of fire there was heavy loss of life. A shell burst killed and wounded most of the signalers as they stood together at their station. An explosion against the opening of the conning tower killed two officers beside Raj Dzhvinsky and slightly wounded the admiral. The fight had not lasted more than 20 minutes, and the Suvorov, the Alexander, and Borodino, the three leading Russian ships, were all wrapped in black smoke from the fires lighted on board them by the Chimose shells. How was the Japanese line faring? I talked over his battle experiences with a Japanese officer not long after the day of Tsushima. He told me his impression was that at first the Russians shot fairly well, causing some loss of life at the more exposed stations on board the leading Japanese ships. But, he added, after the first 20 minutes they seemed suddenly to go all to pieces, and their shooting became wild and almost harmless. No wonder that under such a tornado of explosions, death and destruction, and with their ships ablaze, and range-finding and firing control stations wrecked, the gunnery of the Russians broke down. One of the pithy sayings of the American Admiral Farragut was, "The best protection against the enemy's fire is the steady fire of your own guns." Tsushima gave startling proof of it. Semenov hoped that the Japanese were also suffering from the stress of battle. From the forebridge of the Suvorov, he scanned their line with his glasses. In the sea fights of other wars, both fleets were wrapped in a dense fog of powder smoke. But now with the new powder, there was no smoke except that of bursting shells and burning material, so he could distinguish everything plainly. The enemy had finished turning. His 12 ships were in perfect order at close intervals, steaming parallel to us, but gradually forging ahead. No disorder was noticeable. It seemed to me, with my Zeiss glasses, the distance was a little more than 2 miles, I could distinguish the mantlets of hammocks on the bridges and groups of men. But with us, I looked round. What havoc! Burning bridges, smoldering debris on the decks, piles of dead bodies, signaling and judging distance stations, gun-directing positions, all were destroyed. And astern of us, the Alexander and the Borodino were also wrapped in smoke. End of chapter 14, part 2.
Chapter 14, part 3 of Famous Sea Fights by John R. Hale. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Famous Sea Fights by John R. Hale, Chapter 14, Part 3. Men were killed in the turrets by shell splinters flying through the narrow gun openings. The fire hose was repeatedly cut to ribbons, and the men fighting the fire killed. The injuries caused by near explosions were terrible. Men were literally blown to atoms, or limbs were torn off. 11 wooden boats piled up on the spar deck were a mass of roaring flame. Gun after gun was disabled, and all the while a glance at the Japanese fleet showed them steaming and firing as if at peace maneuvers, without even one of their numerous flagstaffs and signal yards shot away. The battle had not lasted an hour, and it was already evident that it could have only one ending. In the smoke and confusion, Semenov could only see what was happening in the front of the line, but the other ships were exposed to a heavy fire, and had less resisting power. The Osliabya, the fifth of the battleships, and Fölkersham's flagship during the voyage, was the first to succumb. The firing had hardly begun when a 12-inch projectile penetrated her forward above the waterline. In fine weather, the effect would not have been very serious, but the heavy sea flooded her two bow compartments. Then another shell started an armor plate on the waterline amidships, flooded the bunkers on the port side, and gave her a heavy list in that direction. Unsuccessful attempts were made to right her by opening valves and admitting water on the other side. Then a shell burst in the fore turret and put all the crews of the two guns out of action. She was now settling down by the head and heeling over more and more to port. Suddenly the sea reached her lower gun ports and poured into her. Then, like the unfortunate Victoria, she turned turtle and sank. It was at 2:25 that she disappeared thus suddenly, the first battleship ever sunk by gunfire. Three of the destroyers picked up some of the crew who had jumped overboard. As she sank, the three other ships of her division, Sisoy, Navarin, and Nakimov, under the stress of the Japanese fire, sheered for a while out of the line with their upper works ablaze in several places. The four stately battleships at the head of the line had then to face the concentrated attack of the enemy. The Orel was suffering like her consorts. Though her armor was nowhere penetrated, the shells burst their way into her unarmored superstructure and reduced everything on her upper decks to a tangled wreckage. 5 minutes after the Osliabya sank, a shell wrecked the after turret of the Suvorov, tearing the after bridge to pieces with the flying fragments. Her steering gear was temporarily disabled, and she drifted from her station at the head of the line. One by one in quick succession the heavy steel masts and the two huge funnels crashed down. The upper deck was impassable from end to end. In the midst of the confused wreckage, handfuls of brave men fought the fires with buckets as they broke out now here, now there. Most of the guns were silent. "She no longer looked like a ship," says a Japanese account. When the Suvorov swerved out of the line at a few minutes before 3 o'clock, her steering gear had been disabled, and probably for a few minutes before the crisis she had not been answering her helm. The course of the fleet, while she led it during the fight with the Japanese armored fleet, had been due east, but, as she lost her direction, it turned slightly to the south. When she drifted away from the line, the Imperator Alexander III became the leading ship. Captain Buchvostoff, who commanded her, led the fleet in a circle round the disabled Suvorov, first running southwards, increasing the distance from the enemy, and then sweeping round as if trying to break through to the northward. Togo followed on a parallel course until the Russian fleet seemed to be going due south. Then he signaled an order, and, as accurately as if they were performing a practice evolution at maneuvers, his 12 ships turned simultaneously through half a circle, thus reversing the direction and changing the order of the fleet so that the last ship in the line became the leader. As the Russians swept round to the north, Togo was thus ready to cross their bows, and the Alexander received the concentrated fire of several ships. She turned eastwards, followed by her consorts in a straggling line, and then drifted out of her place at the head of it, leaking badly, and with her upper works ablaze. On a smoother sea, the Tsarevich had been hit once below the armor belt on 10 August. The Borodino now had the dangerous post at the head of the line. It steamed eastwards for nearly an hour, followed by Togo on a parallel course, the Japanese fire only slackening when fog and smoke obscured its targets, and the fire of the Russians dwindling minute by minute as gun position after position became untenable or guns were disabled and dismounted. Long before this, the divisions of protected cruisers under Admiral Dewa and his colleagues had worked round to the southward of the Russians. Dewa and Uryu, with their swift ships, were in action by a quarter to three. The slower ships of Takeomi and the younger Togo's squadrons, united under the command of Rear Admiral Kataoka, came into the fight a little later. In the heavy sea that was running, the light cruisers afforded a less steady platform for the guns than the big armored ships, and their fire was not so terribly destructive. But it was effective enough, and that of the Russian rear ships was hopelessly bad. The Japanese cruisers drove the transports and their escort, in a huddled crowd, northeastwards towards the main Russian fleet. The great wall sides of the German liner, now the auxiliary cruiser Ural, were riddled, and the giant began to settle down in the water. The cruiser Svetlana, hit badly in the forepart, was dangerously down by the head. The transports Kamchatka and Irtysh were both set on fire, and the latter was also pierced along the waterline. She sank at 4 o'clock. The Oleo and Aurora were both badly damaged, but the Japanese unarmored cruisers did not escape scatheless. Dewa's fine cruiser, the Kasagi, was badly hit below the waterline, and was in such danger of sinking that he handed the command of his squadron over to Uryu, and, escorted by the Chitose, steamed out of the fight, steering for the Japanese coast. Togo's old ship, the famous Naniwakan, was also hit below the waterline, and had to cease firing and devote all the energy of the crew to saving the ship. At 5 o'clock the Russian fleet, battleships, cruisers, and transports, were huddled together in a confused crowd, attacked from the eastward by Togo and Kamimura with the heavy squadrons, while from the south the line of light cruisers under Uryu and Kataoka poured a crossfire into them. Away to the westward lay the disabled and burning Suvorov, with a Russian naval flag, the blue cross of St. Andrew on a white ground, still flying from a flagstaff in the smoke. The admiral had been twice wounded, the second blow slightly fracturing his skull and making it difficult for him to speak. Her captain, Ignatius, had been simply blown to pieces by a Japanese shell while, after being already twice wounded, he was directing a desperate effort to master the conflagration on board. The decks were strewn with dead, the mess deck full of helpless wounded men. Most of the guns were out of action, but a 6-inch quick-firer and a few lighter guns were kept in action, and drove off the first attempt of the Japanese destroyers to dash in and sink her. Still there was no thought of surrender. The few survivors of her crew fought with dogged Russian courage to the last. A torpedo destroyer, the Buini, taking terrible risks, came up to her, hung on for a few moments to her shattered side, and succeeded in getting off the wounded admiral and a few officers and men. Rojdestvensky sent a last message to Nebogatov, telling him to take over the command and try to get through with some part of the fleet to Vladivostok. About 5:30 some of the Russian ships struggled out of the press, led by the burning Borodino, with the Orel next to her. In the straggling line, battleships and cruisers, armored and unarmored, were mingled together. The Alexander had succeeded in stopping some of her leaks and had rejoined the line. She was near the end of it. The Orel, deserted by her crew, was drifting, till one of Togo's battleships sank her with a few shots. The Russians were now steaming northwards, and for the moment there was no large ship in front of them. The Japanese could have easily headed them off, but Togo now regarded them as a huntsman regards a herd of deer that he is driving before him. The Japanese squadron steamed after them at reduced speed, just keeping it at convenient range, the heavy ships on their right, the light squadrons behind them. At first, the armored ships concentrated their fire on the Alexander. Shells were bursting all over her and throwing up geysers of water about her bows. Then the merciless fire was turned on the Borodino. A few minutes after 7, the Alexander was seen to capsize and disappear. A quarter of an hour later there was an explosion on board of the Borodino. Next moment a patch of foam on the waves showed where she had been. About the same time, a division of torpedo boats came upon the unfortunate Suvorov, torpedoed her, and saved some of the crew, who were found floating on the water after she sank. As the sun went down, and the twilight darkened into night, the firing died away. What was left of the Russian fleet was steaming slowly into the Sea of Japan, some of the ships isolated, others holding together in improvised divisions, all bearing terrible marks of the fight, some of them still on fire, others leaking badly. Togo had been hit during the fight, but it was only a slight bruise. The losses of his fleet had been trifling. Of the armored ships, the only one that had been badly hit was the Asama. She was struck by 3 shells aft, near the waterline. Her rudder was disabled, and she was leaking badly. She left the fighting line for a while, but was able temporarily to repair damages, and rejoined later in the day. At sunset, Togo ordered his squadrons to steam northeastward during the night, and unite at sunrise at a point south of Matsushima, or Ulando Island. They were to keep away from the Russian ships in the darkness. The victorious admiral was about to let loose his torpedo flotillas to complete the destruction of the flying enemy, and meant that his torpedo officers should have no anxiety about hitting friends in the dark. He had, with the main fleet, 21 destroyers organized in 5 squadrons. In the bays of Tsu-shima, nearly 80 torpedo boats had been sheltering all day. The destroyers had been directed to pursue and attack the beaten enemy during the night. No orders had been given to the torpedo boats. The sea was going down, but it was still rough, and Togo had doubts about risking the smaller craft. But without orders, 16 groups of 4 boats each, 64 in all, got up steam and sallied out into the darkness. It was an awful night for the Russians. After dark, they had extinguished the fires lighted by the enemy's shells, and in some cases got collision mats over the leaks. The dead were committed to the sea, the wounded collected and cared for. For more than an hour, they were allowed to hold their course uninterrupted, and the lights of the Japanese fleet were disappearing far astern. After all, Vladivostok might be reached. But just after 8 o'clock the throb of engines, the hurtling beat of propellers, came sounding through the night from all sides. On the sea black, low objects were rushing along with foaming phosphorescent wakes trailing behind them. Bugles ran out the alarm, crews rushed to quarters, searchlights blazed out, and the small quickfirers that were still serviceable mingled their sharp ringing reports with the crackle of machine-gun fire. The sea seemed to be swarming with torpedo craft. They appeared and disappeared in the beams of the searchlights, and the surface of the water was marked with the long white ripples raised by the rush of discharged torpedoes. Loud explosions, now here, now there, told that some of them had found their target, though in the confusion and the rough sea there were more misses than hits. The Sosoi Veliki, which had been on fire in the action, and pierced below the waterline, had a new and more serious leak torn open in her stern. The rudder was damaged and 2 propeller blades torn off, but she floated till next day. Several ships received minor injuries but kept afloat with 1 or more compartments flooded. but the effect of the attack was to disperse the fugitive Russians in all directions. When it began, Nebogatov was at the head of a line of ships in the old battleship Imperator Nikolai I. In the confusion, only three of the line kept up with him, the much-battered Orel, and the Admiral Apraxin, and Admiral Senyavin. The Orel had no searchlight left intact. The Nikolai and the two others did not switch on their searchlights, and kept all other lights shaded. The remarkable result was that as they moved northwards through the darkness they were never attacked, though more than once between 8 p.m. and midnight they saw the enemy's torpedo craft rushing past them. The ships with searchlights drew all the attacks. Admiral Enquist, with his flag in the Oleg, and followed by the Aurora and Jemshug, had run in amongst the remains of the transport flotilla at the first alarm, narrowly escaping collision with them. Then he turned south in the hope of shaking the enemy off, but came upon another flotilla arriving from that direction. He had some narrow escapes. The lookouts of the Oleg counted 17 torpedoes that just missed the ship. Having got away, he tried more than once to turn back to the northward, but each time he ran in among hostile torpedo boats, and saw that beyond them were ships with searchlights working and guns in action, so he steered again south. At last he gave up the attempt and headed for the Tsu-shima Straits. He got safely through them, because the main Japanese fleet was miles away, steaming steadily north, with tired men sleeping by the guns. Next day he was in the open sea with no enemy in sight, and set his course for Shanghai. At midnight the defeated Russians thought they had at last shaken off the pursuit of the sea-wolves, but at 2 a.m. the attacks began again. The Navarin and the Admiral Nakhimov, among the rearmost ships, were attacked by Commander Suzuki's squadron of destroyers. The Navarin was sunk after being hit by two torpedoes. The Nakhimov was severely damaged. About the same time the Vladimir Monomakh and the Dmitry Donskoy were torpedoed, but managed to keep afloat. The attacking force had a good many casualties. Torpedo boats numbers 35 and 65 were sunk by the Russian fire. Their crews were rescued by their consorts. Four destroyers, the Harusami, Akatsuki, Izazuchi, and Yugiri, and two torpedo boats numbers 31 and 68, were so seriously damaged by hostile fire or by collision in the darkness that they were put out of action. As the dawn began to whiten the eastern sky, the torpedo flotillas drew off. At sunrise the Russian fleet was scattered far over the Sea of Japan. Some of the ships for a while steamed alone with neither consort nor enemy in sight within the circle of the horizon. But new dangers came with the day. Togo's fleet was at hand, flinging out a wide net of which the meshes were squadrons and detached cruisers to sweep the sea northwards and gather up the remnants of the defeated enemy. The weather was clearing up, and it was a fine, bright day, just the day for the work the Japanese had to do. Steaming steadily through the night, Togo, with the main body of the Japanese fleet, had passed to eastward of the scattered Russians, and was about 20 miles south of Ulando. The distances covered in the Battle of Tsu-shima were beyond any that had ever been known in naval war. The running fight during the night had passed over more than 150 miles of sea. At 5:20 a.m., the admiral on board the Mikasa received a wireless message from Kataoka's cruisers reporting that they were 60 miles away to the southward of him, and that they could see several columns of black smoke on the horizon to the eastward. Shortly after, Kataoka sent another wireless message. Four of the enemy's battleships and two cruisers are in sight, steering northwest. Togo at once signaled to his own ships to head off this detachment of the enemy, and sent wireless orders to Kataoka and Uryu to close in on their rear. It was probably the main fighting division left to the Russians, and would soon be surrounded by an overwhelming Japanese force. The ships sighted by the cruisers were those that Admiral Nebogatov had led through the night, and was trying to take to Vladivostok. He had with him the battleships Nikolai I and Orel, the coast defense armor-clads Admiral Apraxin and Admiral Senyavin, and the cruisers Izumrud and Svetlana. This last ship was leaking badly and down by the bows. She could not keep up with the others, and at daylight fell far astern and lost sight of them. At 7 a.m., Uryu's division in chase of Nebogatov came up with her, and the cruisers Niitaka and Otawa were detached to capture her. The Russian captain, Shine, had held a council with his officers. He had only 100 shells left in the magazines, and the Svetlana was being kept afloat by her steam pumps. Under the regulations, he could have honorably surrendered to a superior force, but it was unanimously resolved to fight to the last shot, and then sink with colors flying. The fight lasted an hour. There were heavy losses. The Japanese fire riddled the ship, and first the starboard, then the port engine, was disabled. As the 100th shot rang out from the Svetlana's guns, Captain Shine stopped the pumps and opened the seacocks, and the ship settled down rapidly in the water. The Japanese cruisers went off to join the fleet as the Svetlana disappeared, but an armored Japanese liner, the America Maru, stood by and picked up about 100 men. At 10:30 a.m., Nebogatov was completely surrounded 18 miles south of the island of Takashima. The Izumrud had used her superior speed to get away to the southwest. The four battered ships that remained with him saw more than 20 enemies appear from all points of the compass, including Togo's battleships and heavy armored cruisers, all as fit for work as when the first fighting began. They opened fire at long range with their heavy guns. The situation was desperate. Nebogatov consulted his officers, and all those on board the Nikolai agreed that he must surrender. In a memorandum he subsequently wrote, he pointed out that, though some ammunition was left, the Japanese were using their superior speed to keep a distance at which he could not reply effectively to their overwhelming fire. Neither the shore nor other ships were within reach. Most of the boats had been shattered. The rest could not be lowered. Even the life-belts had been burned or used to improvise defenses in the ships. Continued resistance or the act of sinking the ships would only mean the useless sacrifice of some 2,000 men. After the ships had been only a short time in action, during which time they received further severe damage, he hauled down his colors. Togo allowed the Russian officers to retain their swords as a proof of his opinion that they had acted as befitted brave and honorable men. While the brief action with Nebogatov's squadron was in progress, the third of the Russian coast defense battleships, the Admiral Yushakov, hove in sight. She turned off to the westward, pursued by the armored cruisers Iwate and Yakumo. They soon overhauled her and signaled a summons to surrender, adding that Nebogatov had already done so. The Yushakov replied with her 9-inch guns. The cruisers sank her in an hour, and then rescued some 3/4 of her crew of 400 men. The Sisoi Valiki, badly injured in the action of the day before, and torpedoed during the night, was in a sinking condition when the sun rose on 28 May. No ships were in sight. All the boats had been destroyed, and while the pumps were still kept going, the crew was set to work to construct rafts. While this was being done with very scanty materials, the Vladimir Monomach hove in sight, accompanied by this destroyer Iromki. In reply to a signal for help, the Monomach answered that she could do nothing, as she was herself expecting to sink soon. The Iromki offered to take a few men, but the captain of the Sisoi generously refused to deprive the Monomach of her help. The two ships then steamed away. An hour later, the Sisoi was just settling down in the water, when three Japanese armed merchant steamers appeared and took off her crew. At 10:30, the Sisoi heeled over to starboard and sank. Soon after she lost sight of the Sisui, the Monomach came upon the armored cruiser Admiral Nakimov, which also signaled that she was in a sinking condition. Presently there was smoke on the horizon, and then the armed steamer Sadu Maru and the Japanese destroyer Shiranui appeared. In such conditions, the enemies proved a friend. The crews of the two unfortunate ships were transferred to the Sadu, which stood by till, about 10 o'clock, both the Nakimov and the Monomach went to the bottom. The Navarin was comparatively little injured in the battle, but was torpedoed during the night. Leaking badly, she struggled northward at a slow rate till 2 in the afternoon of the 28th, when she was found and attacked by a Japanese destroyer flotilla. She still made a fight with her lighter guns, and was hit by 2 torpedoes. The crew were all at their battle stations when she began suddenly to sink. The order, "All hands on deck," came too late, and very few lives were saved. The armored cruiser Dmitry Donskoy, last survivor of Rozhdestvensky's 14 battleships and armored cruisers, escaped the torpedo attacks in the night and eluded pursuit all through the morning of the 28th. At 4 p.m., when she was near the island of Ulando, she sighted some Japanese ships in the distance, Uryu's cruiser division and some destroyers. They closed slowly on her, and it was not till 6 o'clock that she was attacked by the cruisers Niitaka and Otawa, and 3 destroyers. The Donskoy met a gallant fight for 2 hours, beating off the torpedo boats, losing 60 killed and twice as many wounded, and finally disengaging herself in the darkness about 8 o'clock. The waterline armor was intact, but one boiler was penetrated, and ammunition was nearly exhausted. In the night, the captain, who was himself slightly wounded, decided to land his men on Ulando Island and sink the ship. All the boats had been shattered, and the cutter that was left had to be hastily repaired before it could be lowered. With the one boat, the disembarkation went on slowly during the night. At dawn, the enemy's torpedo boats were sighted. The rest of the crew jumped overboard and swam ashore, leaving a few men with the second in command on the ship. They ran the Donskoy out into 100 fathoms of water, opened the seacocks, embarked in their one boat, and saw their ship go down as they pulled ashore. The Japanese sent a couple of steamers to take the crew off the island. The torpedo destroyer that conveyed the wounded Admiral Rozhdestvensky, Captain Semenov, and a few other officers and men away from the fight, was found and captured by a Japanese flotilla during the afternoon of the 28th. The cruiser Izumrud, with one of the few fast ships the Russians had with them, escaped the torpedo attacks in the night. In the morning she was chased by several of the enemy's cruisers. She kept up a good speed, and one by one they abandoned the chase, the Chitose being the last to give it up. By 2 p.m., all pursuit was left behind, and she reduced speed. In the battle and the chase, she had burned so much coal that she had not enough left to make for Vladivostok, so she steered for Vladimir Bay, in the Russian coast province of Siberia, north of Korea. She was off the entrance of the bay at midnight with only 10 tons of coal left in her bunkers. Unfortunately, in trying to go in the dark on the flood tide, she drove hard on a reef. Next day, unsuccessful efforts were made to get his ship off, and in the afternoon, as her captain expected the enemy's ships might arrive to secure the Izumrud and refloat her, he landed his crew on Russian ground, destroyed his guns one by one with blasting charges, and then blew up the ship. The destroyer Groki was chased and captured by the Japanese destroyer Shiranui, and a torpedo boat, and after a sharp fight close to Tsu-shima Island, surrendered at 11:30 a.m. She was so injured that she sank within an hour of her capture. Admiral Enquist, with the 3 protected cruisers Oleg, Aurora, and Jemshug, had, after turning south for the last time during the night of torpedo attacks, got through the Tsu-shima Straits in the darkness. Next day, no enemy was in sight, and she steered for Shanghai under easy steam, repairing damages on the way. She intended to lie off the port, bring a couple of colliers out of the Wusung River, fill his bunkers at sea, and try to reach Vladivostok by the Pacific and the La Perouse Straits. On the morning of the 29th he was overtaken by the repairing ship and tug Severe, and from her learned the full extent of the disaster. Fearing that if he approached Shanghai he would be driven into the port and blockaded by the enemy, he changed his course for Manila, where he arrived on 3rd of June. The Severe, after communicating with him, had gone on to the Wusung River. She was joined on her way there by the transport Anadir, which had got successfully south through the Tsu-shima Straits. The transport Korea, which had escaped in the same way and had a cargo of coal, did not go to Wusung, but crossed the Indian Ocean and appeared unexpectedly in the French port of Diego Suarez in Madagascar. Of the 9 torpedo destroyers with the Russian fleet, 7 were hunted down and sunk or taken by the Japanese. The only ships of all the Russian armada that finally reached Vladivostok were the 2 destroyers Brawy and Gresny, and the small swift cruiser Almaz. She had been with Enquist's cruiser division in the first hours of the night after the battle. During the torpedo attacks, she had become separated from her consorts. Escaping from the destroyers, she headed at full speed first towards the coast of Japan, then northward. At sunrise on the 28th, she was well on her way and many miles northeast of Togo's fleet. Next day, she reached Vladivostok with 160 tons of coal still on board. 100 years after Trafalgar, Togo had won a victory as complete and as decisive. The Russian power had been swept from the eastern seas, and the gray-haired admiral who had secured this triumph for his native land, Father Togo, as the Japanese affectionately call him, had lived through the whole evolution of the Imperial Navy, had shared in its first successes, and for years had been training it for the great struggle that was to decide who was to be master in the seas of the Far East. The war was followed by an immediate expansion of the Japanese Navy. Numbers of captured Russian ships were repaired, rearmed, and placed in the Navy list under Japanese names. No longer dependent on foreign builders, the Japanese yards were kept busy turning out yet a new navy of every class, from the battleship to the torpedo boat. The laying down of the gigantic Aki and Satsuma, battleships of over 20,000 tons, opened a new period in naval construction, and nations began to count their sea power by the number of dreadnoughts afloat or on the slips. The great maritime powers are now engaged in a race of construction, and the next naval war will see forces in action far surpassing even the armadas that met at Tsu-shima. And maritime war, hitherto confined to the surface of the sea, will have strange auxiliaries in the submarines stealing beneath it, and the airship and aeroplane scouting in the upper air. But still, whatever new appliances, whatever means of mutual destruction science supplies, the lesson taught by the story of all naval war will remain true. Victory will depend not on elaborate mechanical structures and appliances, but on the men, and will be the reward of long training, iron discipline, calm, enduring courage, and the leadership that can inspire confidence, command self-sacrificing obedience, divine an enemy's plans, and decide swiftly and resolutely on the way in which they are to be frustrated. End of chapter 14. This is the end of Famous Sea Fights by John R. Hale.